Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Lord, unveil my eyes, let me see you face to face, the knowledge of your love as you live in me. Lord, renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life, in living every day, by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. And I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your
true that you are thinking of. shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Amen. I sent my word and healed your disease.
Absolutely.
Only one.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Resurrection Beach MCC. If you can go ahead and get your seats taken so that we can get our service started. And so Meg is with us this evening doing the music, so I'm looking forward to that. It's going to be amazing music, I know. And so let's go ahead, and we are going to get started with, let's see, I think the first one is...
Rise up and praise
him. Yes, rise up and praise him.
All right, so you don't have to rise up if that's a little difficult, but maybe when it says rise up and praise him, you can just kind of throw your hands up in the air. Thank you.
we can still rise up spiritually and praise him. And so let's open our service in prayer right now, shall we? Holy and loving God, we thank you for bringing us together tonight to be community together, to give us that respite from the events of the day that have tired us out. And so we just pray, dear God, that this entire service would be pleasing unto you, that it would glorify and honor your holy name, and that it would be a blessing unto you. And all of this we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so, all right, announcements. Yes. So what's our first one there, Benjamin?
1 second.
Okay, that's fine. So let me see. Today's the 20th. Yesterday, Harry had a birthday. And then coming up the middle of the week, let's see, I think that must be today's the 28th, right? 30. So Tuesday, Tom has a birthday. And then coming up on May 2nd, Randy has a birthday. So on three, let's just wish them all a happy birthday, shall we? Uno, dos, tres.
Happy birthday!
All right. And so go ahead and give me that more of that beautiful bean footage, Benjamin, with the next slide. Yes, duffel bags. We do those every month. I did drop off 16 of them on Monday. And so, you know, this is an ongoing ministry that we have where we provide duffel bags to the Youth Crisis Center so that the kids, that when they leave there, they don't take their stuff with them in a black trash bag. Mm-hmm. So can you imagine what that must be like when you're going into foster care or something like that? To have all of your stuff in a 55-gallon black plastic trash bag? Pretty scary, huh? So that's what we do. That's one of the things that we do. So go ahead and give me more of that slides there, Benjamin. Yes, so coming up on May 19th, which is Pentecost Sunday, we are going to be stuffing our bags of blessings. And so we have some stuff to bless today. And so we've got a couple of things here. We've got some red, white, and blue socks that have been donated.
Wow.
And we have 300 non-alcoholic wipes that have been donated as well. So let's go ahead and bless these today. And then we will put them with all the rest of the items that are going to be put into those bag of blessings on May 19th. So at 3 o'clock. So if you're available, come on out. Because the more hands we have, the better. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So,
go quicker and faster.
Many hands make light work. And so we get to sit around and have a good time too.
Yes, absolutely.
Let's bless these, shall we? Holy and loving God, we just ask that you would bless these socks, that they would warm the feet of those who put them on, that we keep them dry and safe. And we also ask, dear God, that you would bless and anoint these non-alcoholic wipes so that the germs and the bacteria from everyday life would be removed from our unhomed siblings so that they can go and have a wonderful day. And all of this we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And so then, what's next? Yes. So Pride events are coming up, and actually Debbie was just at Ladera Valley Ranch Pride cookout this afternoon, picnic, I guess they call it. And so things are gearing up. We're going to be at Mission Viejo Pride, first one ever that they've done. That'll be coming up, I think, in June, right? And then we'll be looking at other Ladera Ranch and some more of those smaller ones as well as, and I do know that Orange County Pride is going to be at the Orange County Fair this year. So they've moved that venue out to the fairgrounds. I need to get more information on that. But so, yes, there are going to be several of them. And it's nice to see that so many of them are happening. Even out in the Palm Springs area, Cathedral City has their own now. I think Desert Hot Springs has their own now. And so all of these smaller towns, Downey has a Pride event now. Pico Rivera has a Pride celebration. So all of these smaller towns and cities are starting to have their own Pride events to show, you know, you don't just have to live in the big city, right? It's kind of like the movie Tu Wong Fu that we watched last night at Good Sam.
Oh, it was so fun.
There's so much more acceptance out there in the world, isn't there? So we need to be at the forefront of that. So that's coming up, and we'll have more information on that as they become available. And so go ahead and fire it up there for me, Benjamin. So yes, and so as part of Pride, I'm going to be putting together the spiritual gifts assessment so that we can see what our talents are, where we may need to do some education so that we can be prepared for all of these families that are starting to attend Pride events, and so that we can be more of what God is calling us to be. So go ahead and move me through, Benjamin. Yes, January. I did that last week too. Saturday, June 1st at 7 p.m., the Orange County Women's Chorus is going to be performing a Wings concert, which is travel, adventure, and creatures of the sky. If you're interested in going to that, please let me know, and I will make sure that you have information so that you can purchase your ticket, which I believe is $25 plus like a $2 or $3 service fee. So it's like $27 all in. So that's coming up on June 1st, and then we'll keep you posted on other, like the Metal Live concert and women's concerts and all of that into the future. So what's next, Benjamin? So coming up in June, I don't know exactly what date yet, we are going to be having an evening to remember Chuck Anderson. And so, you know, he lived Pride every day. He would show up at church on a Sunday night, and if his outfit didn't match his sunglasses, didn't match his flip-flops, there was a problem. And it was usually fluorescent orange, fluorescent green, lime, some bright color. And he lived Pride every day, and he also loved pork chops. So we're going to have a pork chop dinner with some of the other foods that he loved, and so that we can just honor his memory of how many lives he touched through the year. And so, yes, he was as vibrant in life as the colors of clothes that he wore. And so we're going to be honoring him sometime during the month of June, because he lived Pride every day. And so what's after that, Benjamin? Yes, so we are preparing for Strength for the Journey. And that is a Methodist-run retreat camp for people who are HIV positive or have AIDS. We usually send about 6 or 8 people as staff. We had a staff meeting yesterday, and actually our second one of the year already. And so it's never too early to start thinking about snacks, because these folks love snacks when it comes to their evening entertainment. And then also to be cleaning out those closets of maybe those coats that don't fit anymore, or blankets or flannel shirts or all of those things. And so if we can have the next two slides, Benjamin, that'll give us some ideas. So yes, they love chips. They especially love popcorn. They love the nuts and fruit snacks and crackers and cheese and candy bars, and they love all of that stuff. So we'll be collecting those snacks up through August 12th, because we leave for camp on the 13th, I believe it is, isn't it? Monday the 13th, I think. And so we'll be collecting these up through probably starting like the last 2 weeks in July into the first two Sundays in August. First two Sundays in August, so that we can take all that with us on the next day on Monday. And then when it comes to Mama's Closet, if we can have that slide, Benjamin. Yes, so there's jeans that they'll be needing. You know, there's flannel shirts because it gets cold up there. There's blankets and towels and coats. So if you have any of that stuff that you would like to donate, again, bring it in the last 2 weeks in July, first couple of weeks in August, and we will make sure that they find a good home. So I think that's the announcements for today. I think, yes. So I know that that brings us to our offering time. And so of course, as you can see, we're less than 50% of the way through the month, and this is the last Sunday. So it may be a short month, and hopefully there'll be enough to cover the rent, which is due in a couple of days. I think there's almost enough in the bank right now for that. If not, you know, we do have a savings account that we can draw against if we absolutely have to. And when it comes to funding some of the ministry events, we do that out of our own pocket if we don't have enough funds coming in. And of course, you know, there's always needs, right? And so Theta here, who is our tie-dye pig, absolutely loves a little bit of coinage and some greenery. And so what Theta does is helps out with disaster ideas, or we recently provided funds for a victim of domestic violence to get them out of here and back to their family in Oklahoma. And so that's what Theta, which by the way is the Greek for gift from God or giving to God. And so how appropriate that our tie-dye pig has that name. So I'm going to set, and I'm not going to do it by the nose, I will set it down. So I will put the tie-dye pig there. And if you'd like to make a donation to the church, there's multiple ways that you can do that. If I can have that slide, Benjamin.
It
should be the next
there.
One. Oh, is it not there?
This one.
No. Ah, I guess I zigged when I should have zagged. So I'll do this from memory. There's multiple ways that you can make a donation if you would like to. You can Zell us at the church number, 714-662-6972. You can go to our website, rbmcc.org, and you can click on the yellow donate button. It'll take you up to PayPal, which is a secure website, so you can make a donation there. You can drop us a check in the mail at Resurrection Beach MCC, 11037 Warner Avenue, number 130 in beautiful Fountain Valley, California, 92708. Or you can come here and be with us. And are y'all getting a little warm? All right, so when we go into praise and worship then, I will go turn the AC back on, because it looks to me like some of you are fading like I am. So while we're receiving our offering, Meg is gonna come and start us with our praise and worship. And I'm going to go turn the AC back on.
Okay.
All right. Well, Pastor Dale's message today is going to be about the fruits of God, and which should be manifested in our lives. And so I thought we'd do a fun song called the Fruit of the Spirit song. So it should be up on the screen there.
Like a tasty banana, and apple.
patience.
Say kindness.
Kindness.
Say goodness.
Goodness.
Say faithfulness.
Faithfulness.
Gentleness and self-control.
Gentleness and self-control.
Army church that I go to, we're going to have a ladies' tea party on Wednesday. Anybody who wants to go, just let me know. It's in Tustin. So if you're interested, you're welcome to come to it. So I think it's going to be fun. All right. So another part of the sermon today is going to have to do with God sending his son, that he loved us so much that he sent his son for us. And so I figured we'd do this God So Loves song that talks about that.
Oh,
about it, didn't you?
Oh, well, maybe we took it off since I always forget it.
That may be.
All right. Well, we've done this one before in church, but it's been quite a while. It's called You Are the Light, and it talks about how God is our light. And, you know, just like the moon reflects the light of the sun and gives us light at night, mm-hmm. we reflect the light of God's love into other people's lives. So that's what this song is all about. We are the people of God, the sons and the daughters of love, forgiven, restored, and redeemed, living our lives to the praise of our King. We are the ones who will shine in His light in the darkness of night, to the hopeless, broken and poor. They will be hopeless and broken no more. You are the light, light of the world, and we shine you more. You are the light, light of the world, and we shine you more. Now we have to go back to the beginning, and I forgot to put that on Pastor Dale's message. Slideshow there, if you go back to the beginning of this song.
Actually, it might already be.
Is it? Oh, it is, yay! Maybe I didn't tell everyone. All right. We are the people of God, the sons and the daughters of love, forgiven, restored, and redeemed, living our lives to the praise of our depressed or something. And, you know, there, I've heard a story of a lady on the radio just recently, and she was about to end her life or something because she was so depressed. And she met somebody, and they just talked with her and smiled, and and just let her know, you know, how much she was appreciated and everything. And when she went home, she thought, you know, I don't think I'm going to end my life. I think I'm going to keep living, you know. So I went to a Peter Paul Without Mary concert last night because Mary unfortunately passed away a few years ago of cancer. But anyway, one of the songs that they sang was This Little Light of Mine, because I guess that was kind of a protest song back, you know, in the 60s. and so I was kind of surprised that they sang that, but, you know, everybody in the audience knew it. They were all singing along and everything. We're not singing that tonight, but but, you know, we are all little lights in the world, you know, reflecting God's love. And so we just need to shine that light around to everyone that we meet. So we're going to do this song called Build My Life. And I've done this before. And my favorite part is when they're talking in the chorus and they said, show me who you are, talking about the Lord, and fill me with your heart, because Jesus has such a heart of love for everyone. And lead me in your love to those around me, so that we might show love, his love, to everyone.
Amen.
The only one who could ever say,
scriptures. And Meg has graciously agreed to read one of the scriptures for us this evening.
We keep her busy.
Yes, we do.
Well, this is one of my favorites out of 1 John, talking about God is love. And you know, in at Calvary Chapel, back in the 1970s or whatever, they had a song that actually said these words in the very beginning of this. And it said, love one another, because God love comes from God. He who loves is a child of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God. For God is love. God is love.
Oh, beautiful.
So, and God showed his love for us by sending his only son into the world so that we might have life through him. This is what love is. It is not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the means by which our sins are forgiven. Dear friends, if this is how God loved us, then we should love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in union with us, and his love is made perfect in us. We are sure that we live in union with God and that he lives in union with us because he has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and tell others that the Father sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If we declare that Jesus is the Son of God, we live in union with God and God lives in union with us. And we ourselves know and believe the love which God has for us. God is love, and those who live in love live in union with God, and God lives in union with them. Love is made perfect in us in order that we may have courage on the judgment day, and we will have it because our life in this world is the same as Christ's. There is no fear in love. Perfect love drives out all fear. So then, love has not been made perfect in anyone who is afraid, because fear has to do with punishment. We love God because God first loved us. If we say we love God but we hate others, we're liars. For we cannot love God who we have not seen, and do not love others whom we have seen. The command that Christ has given us is this: whoever loves God must love others also.
And so our second reading for this evening is from John 15, verses 1 through 8, from the Passion Translation. I am a true sprouting vine, and the farmer who tends the vine is my Father. He cares for the branches connected to me by lifting and propping up the fruitless branches and pruning every fruitful branch to yield a greater harvest. The words I have spoken over you have already cleansed you, so you must remain in life union with me, for I remain in life union with you. For as a branch severed from the vine will not bear fruit, so your life will be fruitless unless you live your life intimately joined to me. I am the sprouting vine, and you are my branches. And as you live in union with me as your source, fruitfulness will stream from within you, but when you live separated from me, you are powerless. If a person is separated from me, he is discarded. Such branches are gathered up and thrown into the fire to be burned. But if you live in life union with me, and if my words live powerfully within you, then you can ask whatever you desire, and it will be done. When your lives bear abundant fruit, you demonstrate that you are my mature disciples who glorify my Father. Here ends the reading of the word. And so, our message for today from our scriptures, and Benjamin, if you can bring up that service image slide for me, please.
The next one. Right.
Yeah. That one.
It was all the way at the beginning.
Oh, there should have been one in the middle, but okay. And so, As it says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. And that is from John 15:5. And so you'll notice that those bunches of fruit there are hearts filled with love and compassion and caring. And so our messages for today is indeed about bearing good fruit, bearing the good fruit of God through Jesus Christ as the vine. And so Jesus Christ as the vine, just like those sturdy vines and branches there, receive their moisture from the root, and the root being God, and distribute it to the branches, us, so that we can provide good, sweet fruit to others from the seed of God, which is love. And so in Galatians 5:22 and 23, tells us that these are the fruits of the Spirit, which match to the song, Fruit of the Spirit, that Meg sang. And so they are love, joy, peace, forbearance, which actually means refraining from enforcing something such as a debt. Also having patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, and of course, as I said, patience, because usually we need a double dose of patience, don't we? Oftentimes we do. And notice that this list starts with love. Do you think that's a coincidence? I think not, because I believe that all the fruits of the Spirit start with love from God. And so, you know, if we think about it logically, what is the root, the base, the very foundation of what makes us tick as caring, supportive, uplifting humans? Is it greed? Oh, definitely not. Is it talking about and thinking about ourselves only? Absolutely not. Is it rudeness? Is it pushiness? Taking what isn't ours to take? Certainly not. And certainly none of these have anything to do to offer towards being caring, supportive, uplifting humans. A classic example, Friday evening, well, late Friday evening, I was at LAX to pick up Fernando. He'd been gone for a week to visit friends in Illinois. His flight arrived at 11 p.m., well, 10:44 p.m. And by the time he made it from wherever he was at to the arrival level next to a column and called me and told me where he was, it was already 11:30. It took me another 20 minutes to go 2,000 feet to pick him up. So right in front of me is a big tour bus. Well, okay, you're bigger than I am. I'm going to let you go. Well, right behind the tour bus was a young woman in an SUV, never even paid attention to the fact that I was right there, and pulled right on out, and I said a few choice words. And then Fernanda was like, you really shouldn't talk like that. Oh, okay. But I had no patience at that moment. I wanted to get home and go to bed. And as it was like 12:45 when we got home. Mm-hmm. And he had to get up at 6:00 in the morning to go to work because he worked a double that next day. And I had to be up at 7:00. So I was a little bit cranky, and I shouldn't have been. So I definitely needed a double dose of patience right then. And I should have had it, but I didn't. So what is the root, the base, the very foundation of Jesus as the vine, as our vine? Jesus wasn't all about himself. He wasn't greedy. He wasn't rude or pushy. All he was loving. Jesus as the vine came to earth to teach people, to show people, to be a living example of God's love for all, even the ones who were against him. He still loved them, even though he hoped that he could teach them how to be the better person, how to truly love God, and to let go of some of the laws that they had were living in. that's what he really wanted, but he still loved them. He wanted to love them into wholeness. And so God's love for us is the seeds of all the fruits of the spirits, right? Because without the seed of God's love, our fruits of the spirit would be sour fruit. You know, we all know folks who do take some great, what do I say, joy in going through life with a sour puss, looking like they are sucking on a sour lemon 24/7. The other night, let's see, I guess while I was waiting for Fernando's flight to come in, I was watching, Sister Boniface on BritBox. She's a nun in the 1940s, 50s, England, probably 1950s, who has a killer lab because she is the world's forensic expert, and the police all rely on her to solve all of their crimes. Well, there is this one woman there who runs a boarding house, and she, the church lady ain't got anything on her. She has the world's worst lemon-sucking push you'd ever want to see, and she does not look happy ever, and everybody kind of avoids her like the plague. Any wonder? Because, you know, sour fruit, a sour puss look, sour grapes, sour apples, sour lemons, they are not appealing. Unless you can put 1,500 pounds of sugar on them and make them sweet. Well, that won't happen either. And the same as when we are going through life with a sour puss. You know, when we go through life with that negative Nelly attitude, certain that we are always the victim in all situations. Not very appealing, is it? And it tends to make us run the other way. Pick up our skirts and run as far as we can get. And you know, as much as some people relish being a sour puss is definitely not one of the fruits of the Spirit. It's not in any of Meg's songs about fruit of the Spirit. It's not in the scriptures about being a sour puss. So therefore, we can determine that it is not one of the fruits of the Spirit. And it is not based on God's love. And you know, sure as I stand right here before you, in all of my splendor and finery, the seeds of greed, injustice, inequality, being all about me, those will never be the seeds of good fruit for God's love. And the vine of Jesus is steady, it's strong, it's true, and it provides all the nutrients that we need to be good, strong branches, bearing huge clusters of the most amazing, sweet, life-giving, put a smile on the face of the people around you, fruit of God. If, for example, the vine of Jesus was rooted in anything other than God's love, well, I really don't think the vine would exist at all. It certainly would not be the vine of Jesus. Now, it might be the vine of the devil, which would be nothing that would support life because it would be gnarled and it would be hard and it would be life draining instead of life giving. It would be sucking all the nutrients back from the branches and the leaves down into the trunk and into the root so that it could survive. Because it wouldn't care about us. It doesn't care about us at all. And so if God's love wasn't providing the nutrients for the vine of Jesus and to the branches of you and I, the fruit that we would bear would be non-existent because all of that nutrients and energy would be back down in the ground. And we're not in the ground, are we? We are above ground. And so you see, God's love provides the nutrients, the goodness, the life-giving moisture that is needed to make that vine strong and to make us as branches supple. and able to carry the weight of those big, gorgeous, beautiful bunches of fruit. And so, the only thing that would detract from us would be those nasty sucker branches. And you know, we all know there are some people in our lives occasionally who are a sucker branch, aren't they? They drain us of all of our energy. They take away our nutrients. They take all of our time and leave us with nothing that we can do for God or for others. And so, you know, just like the farmer who has to sometimes prune sucker branches or dead limbs or things like that, sometimes, you know, we have to do that with others, don't we? Because if we don't, then we may not be the good branches that we need to be. We may be, like it says in Scripture, we may be pruned away and thrown into the fire. You know, I remember back when I lived in Rochester, New York, and I'd come home from work at the end of the day of managing that lumber company that I was at, and I'd go out onto my back deck and I'd survey my fiefdom and look at all my flower beds, and there was petunia plants. As the blossoms would only last a couple of days and then they would start to die off. So I would very methodically go from plant to plant and I would pinch off those dead and dying blossoms. And so what it did is, of course, first it made the plant look naked sometimes, but much stronger. And in the end, those bushes became huge, filled with more and more blossoms every day, and they lasted a long time in the growing season. So sometimes, you know, we need to take a pinch here and a pinch there, don't we? Just so that we can continue to grow and to blossom. And you know, when I moved to Norfolk, Virginia, I had crepe myrtle trees in the front between the sidewalk and the street. And they are notorious for growing from their root way out. And so one of them grew like 15 feet away from the one tree that I had, and that we had a snowstorm or something, and my next door neighbor kind of missed their driveway and accidentally hit what was growing there. So in the spring, I dug it out and transplanted it because it wasn't a sucker branch. It was from the root and it was growing. And of course, my neighbor across the street, a know-it-all, she came over and she said, "Well, you can't do that in the middle of July because it's going to die." I thought, "Oh, really?" So I dug a hole, put a couple of gallons of water in there, plopped that sucker in there, put it, covered it with some dirt. And guess what? I ended up with three more crepe myrtle trees. Now, granted, there were some sucker branches that came on all of them, and so I had to trim them off. But that's okay, because that allowed that tree to continue to grow. And, you know, and then in the backyard, I had purchased a rose of Sharon bush. And the late Reverend Elder, not Reverend Elder, the late Reverend Dolores Berry used to sing a song about the rose of Sharon. So I went and purchased this bush and I planted it. And then one summer, I don't know, we were preparing for, I don't know, a dozen or so hurricanes. So I was putting in a lot of hours at work and I had no time for any yard work or anything. And after hurricane season had ended in November, I was out there and I was looking at that rose of Sharon bush, and it had like no blossoms on it, and a million sucker branches. I got out my loping shears, and I cut all of those sucker branches out, cut them up into little pieces so they could go into the composting bin. And then the next spring, I had the most beautiful, abundant rose of Sharon blossoms that you could ever imagine. And it looked fabulous. So sometimes we have to do a little pruning, don't we? And you know, Mike, I remember I was a kid. My grandfather had an apple orchard. And he used to lovingly take care of all of those, I don't know, 200-300 apple trees that he had with multiple different varieties. But in the wintertime, he'd put on that heavy winter clothes and he'd go out and he'd cut down and cut back the dead limbs. Sometimes he had to cut down a whole tree because if he had a tree that was infested with some kind of disease, he didn't want it spreading to the rest of the trees. And so he would trim those away. And so it does make you think, so here's somebody who nurtured these trees for 30 years, but yet had to cut them down and trim them back. It makes you think a little bit, doesn't it? Because sometimes in our lives, you know, there may be people who have been in our lives for 30 years or more. Mm-hmm. And for whatever reason, perhaps they've become toxic. And they're not healthy to be around. And so sometimes we have to do the loving thing that we hate to do. We have to distance ourselves. You know, just as like Jesus said, you know, if you're not bearing fruit, you know, you'll have to be pruned. You know, those of you who have rose bushes, you love those rose bushes, don't you? And they give beautiful blossoms. But every year you have to trim them back, because if you don't, you're going to end up with runners that are a half a mile long and no blossoms. And one of the people at Good Sam this morning was sharing that he was living somewhere and this person had 53 rose bushes. Well, on one of them, it literally had a runner that had grown all the way up in the tree. So it was, I don't know, 70 feet long, something like that. And that bush had one rose blossom. And that was it. He cut the runner, eventually pulled it all out of the tree, and the next spring, that rose bush was full of blossoms. So sometimes we have to do the thing that's difficult, don't we? Mm-hmm. And you know, Jesus never wants to have to trim us off from the vine. All Jesus wants us to do is to be the seed, to carry the seed of God, the love, and to create beautiful bunches of sweet fruits of the Spirit. And that's all we have to do. It's not like we have to go down into the ground. We don't have to suck up the water. We don't have to carry it up the vine like Jesus does. All we have to do is receive it. Receive it and let the seed of God, the love of God, nurture us and fill us, make us supple and flexible. Because, you know, rigidity isn't a good thing always. It's never a good thing, actually. We need to be flexible and supple. And then from that, we can create and bring forth into fruition these beautiful bunches of fruit that will be the fruits of the Spirit. All 8 or 9 of them, I think there are. Yeah, something like that. So that's what we need to do. We need to allow Jesus to continue to be our vine, to provide us with everything that we need from God, so that we can do what God is calling us to do, which is to be the bearer of the fruit of the Spirit and to share it with others. So, may you all be a bunch of grapes. God bless. So that brings us to family prayer. And I'm trying to remember what some of the prayer requests were this week. I know for Jan Purcell, we needed to be in prayer for her because they removed a spot off from her lip and it was benign. And they did a bit of a biopsy on a lump under her tongue, but they were not able to get any results from that. So now she has to make an appointment with a specialist down in Scottsdale, which is quite a drive. And she's waiting to get in, and you know, she had finally, you know, she had been able to settle herself down and to be ready for that. And then she finds out that they can't tell what's going on with this other lump. So now she has to wait, get another appointment, drive down to Scottsdale, have the test results done, and then go through all of this emotional turmoil all over again. So we need to keep her in prayer. We need to continue to keep Sarah and everybody in prayer because she had to take the dog in to have surgery. What day was that, Benjamin?
I think that was...
Was it Tuesday, maybe?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. And then, of course, praises that she got her vehicle back.
Yeah.
And the ominous phone call that she had gotten last Friday, a week ago Friday, turned out to be just one small little more part that was needed that was not expensive. So she was much happier with that. So praises for that. Praises and pray that Hannah, she's only 2 days away from making it 2 months without any doctor emergency visit. So prayers for that. Praises for the Pride picnic that Debbie attended today for us, so that our presence is continuing to be known and seen for Ladera Valley Ranch Pride. Let's see, what else do I know?
Not touching that line.
Yeah, I don't know much. Praises for, well, a good meeting for Strength for the Journey yesterday.
Yeah.
So that's moving forward nicely. Praises that all of you are here with us this evening. Continued prayers for your friend Jill, who's continuing to go through cancer treatment.
Yes.
Praises that Sarah and OC got the insurance authorization for OC surgery on, I think it's the 8th or the 13th?
13th.
Yeah, Robert Reedy has some kind of dental surgery on the 8th, I believe it is, to follow up with his oral surgeon, because there's spots in his mouth as well. So we need to keep all these folks in prayer. Does anybody have a prayer request? Yes?
I'd like to have prayer for my friend, my good friend Nancy, who lives in Porterville.
Okay.
Her husband of 25 years passed away last week, and
oh, no.
It wasn't unexpected because he had been ill for quite a while,
and
treatments for cancer and various things, and I think he was in a lot of pain, so. But still, you know, leaves a big, you know, in her life and in her son's life, because he was, even though he wasn't the father of her son, he always treated her son like his own son. So the two of them are really, you know, grieving.
So Nancy
and Eric is her son.
Eric, okay. And then we also need to keep, Jan Hinman had texted me during service last Sunday that there's a gentleman in her 55 plus community who had kind of been a pseudo chaplain there, and he had a stroke last Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And so prayers for that. Continued prayers for Kevin, who's waiting to hear which one of the groceries chains is going to actually snap him up.
They did.
Oh, they did?
Yeah.
Which one?
Ralph's on Golden West.
Oh, very nice. So when do you start?
I already started.
Oh,
yesterday.
I know, I'm so glad.
You didn't send me a text.
I know. I want to make sure it was for sure. For
oh. So, praises for that. Yes, Marty.
I have a praise.
Yes.
My knee is completely healed.
Oh, good.
I had physical therapy in home. Now I'm going to start physical therapy out tomorrow. So,
oh, nice.
But it's wonderful.
Praise.
That's good.
Yeah. I'm not in any pain. It's just completely healed. So,
good.
Wonderful.
God is good.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Any other prayer requests or praise reports? Okay. Silent requests? All right, let's go to God in prayer, shall we? Holy and loving God, we thank you, first of all, for the answered prayers for work, to be able to go and be with other people and to be able to do what is loved the most. Some serious cooking, I assume. And prayers for a good friend, Nancy, and her son, Eric, who Nancy's husband and Eric's dad has passed away recently. And so we just ask, dear God, that you would put in their lives the support network, the resources to help them through this difficult time, to get them the resources that they need to be able to move forward, to be able to reestablish their lives and the things that they need to be able to do, and give them the opportunity to remember the good times, to allow those good times to surround them as they move forward from each new day into the areas that they need to go into, to the things that they need to take care of, and to be able to live their lives as a celebration of the life that is now in heaven. And we give you praises also, Holy God, that injuries have been healed, that there is no more pain there. And we thank you also, Holy God, for lifting up Hannah and giving her the ability to not have to go to an emergency room or urgent care for almost 2 months. And we're going to continue to pray that she doesn't need to do that at all from now until the rest of the pregnancy, so that she can have a stress-free pregnancy. And we thank you, Holy God, for all of these towns that are opening up and being ready to receive and to promote pride and acceptance and diversity, and that they're coming to a place where they realize that it is more important to accept and to be loving and caring and supportive rather than being divisive and trying to tear things apart. So all of this we ask, dear God, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
So that brings us to our time of communion. And so we're going to consecrate these elements, and then while our elements are being distributed, Meg will be leading us in singing the song,
Come As You Are.
Come As You Are. So, Holy God, we just ask right now that you would anoint these elements of grains, of fruit of the vine, that you would make them for us representative of the body and the blood of Christ Jesus, and that in our receiving these, that we would be reminded, that we would be renewed, that we would feel God's love coming to us through Jesus Christ, and that we would be filled to overflowing yet again with the fruits of the Spirit, and that we would be about doing what you want us to do, Holy God. And all of this we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
So we gather together at this time so that we can remember the events that took place in the upper room that night, when Jesus was gathered there with his disciples, the people he'd been in ministry with for the last 3 years or so, his family of choice, just as we gather together right here as family of choice. And so after they had consumed the meal, and Jesus had washed the feet of those gathered there out of an act of servanthood, he returned to the table and he picked up a piece of unleavened bread. He raised it toward heaven, he blessed it, he gave thanks for it, he broke it. And he told those gathered there, this bread represents my body, which will be broken for the forgiveness of your sins. And whenever you eat of this bread, remember me. He passed it among them, and they consumed it. And when they had consumed the bread, Jesus reached into the center of the table and he picked up a cup of wine. We believe it to be the cup of Elijah put out in anticipation of the coming Messiah. He raised it toward heaven, he blessed it, he gave thanks for it, and then he breathed into it with the very same breath, the same essence, the same spirit that God had breathed into Adam. And he said, this cup represents the new covenant I make with you today, the covenant of my blood. And whenever you receive of this cup, receive again that covenant, that commitment, that promise that I make with you now. He passed it among them, and they consumed it as well. Holy and loving God, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, for the sacrifice that he made, for the willingness to be the vine that provides for us the moisture, the nutrients, the love of God, so that we can be the branches that we are needed to be. So we just ask that as we receive communion each time, that we would be renewed and restored. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen.
So that brings us to our closing song. The plume is excited.
Yes.
So our closing song will be, May the Good Lord Bless and Keep You, which is our prayer for you.
Sorry.
During this week, the Lord will bless you and keep you safe from all harm. May the good Lord bless and keep you, whether near or far away. May you find that long-awaited golden day today. May your troubles, all these small ones, and your fortunes, virtually, or whether that's in person, wherever it is, until we are able to meet again, may you be blessed, and may you be a blessing to others.
And so, speaking of blessings and being blessed, a huge thank you to Meg for the musical team. Kevin and Benjamin for covering the camera and the computer and PowerPoint. And to all of you for coming out Sunday evening and being with us. And for those of you who are going to be watching us later, God bless you and may you have a wonderful week. God bless.
And thank you, Pastor Dale.